Today we will have, I decided to switch with Netta, so we will have 2 hours of lecture today, and on Tuesday there's an extra hour at 11, so Netta will do the TA then, just so that we will finish some topics before the TA. She will have a regular TA also on Thursday. And the other thing, so next week we have an extra hour, but I still owe you 1 more hour, because on the week of SFN, on Thursday, I didn't teach.
So let's do 6 hours in a row?
No, no.
What?
No, but on the last week of the semester, this is... On the last week of the semester, this is 2 weeks after next week. We didn't schedule an extra hour, so I will do that. I will also send you a message. Okay? We really need this time, because we also lost the first week, and this we're not supposed to... give back according to the decisions of the university. Alright, so we're continuing our discussion of entropy, and the situation is with our n symbols, and I told you that if you try to encode and the symbols appear with probabilities pi. And if you try to encode a long stream of these symbols, a fundamental theorem proven by Shannon tells us that the number of bits that you will need per symbol, on average, whatever encoding scheme you devise, is at least given by the entropy. And the entropy is sum over I, pi, log in base 2 of 1 over pi, which we can also write as minus sum over I, pi, log 2 of pi. And now what I want to do is to go through several simple examples to see that this expression makes sense. I will not prove this. And so the first example, let's do it here. The first example will be the case where all the symbols appear with the same probability. Oh, this is not good. Okay. All right, so first example is all pi are the same, and therefore you know what? No, okay, we'll start with that. Fine. Pi is 1 over n. Okay. What is then the entropy? Come on. Did you reach Shannon entropy in Talith calls?
Just
now. Okay, so we'll do it concurrently. Let's look at here. Log base 2 of 1 over p is what? Come on.
Log of n.
Log 2 of n. And what happens in the sum over I? It gives us 1, right? Because all are the same. So the entropy is log in base 2 of n. Does this make sense? Let's imagine that n is equal to 8. There are 8 symbols that we want to encode. 8 possible symbols. So we need 3 bits, which makes sense because there are 8 different code words, bit words of 3 bits, right? Each bit can be 0 or 1, so there are 8 different combinations of the 3 bits. It makes sense that we need 3 bits to encode 8 symbols. All right, but this is more general. I mean, okay, if n is a power of 2, you can clearly see how you would encode, how would you encode in a way that achieves the limit given by the entropy. If n is 15, it's less clear, but it's still true that if you want to encode a long symbol of a long stream of symbols, the number of bits that you will need per symbol is log 2 of 15. All right. Example 2. Let's imagine that one of the symbols is 1, is the probability of 1. Always you know, one of the symbols appears with probability 1 without loss of generality. Let's assume that it's the first one. And then all the other ones appear with probability 0. This means that each time you observe a symbol, it's always the first symbol. How many bits do you need? Okay, why is it 0? Okay, so mathematically it's 0 because, you know, log of 1 is 0, so we have 1 times 0. And for the other one, we have here 0 times log of infinity, but it's, you know, the function log, let's look at this function. P log P, the function, this function approaches 0 when P goes to 0, right? So, I mean, it's a bit confusing. If P is 0, what should we put here? The answer is we should look, because this is, if P is 0, this is 0, but this is infinite. But if you want to understand what is written here in this case, we should ask what is the limit of this function when P goes to 0, and this limit is 0. P goes to 0 faster than the way log goes to infinity. Okay, so for the 0 symbols, we have here 0. Anyway, so what this means is that the entropy is indeed 0, but we also heard the answer to why this is the case, not the mathematical answer, and this is that if we know all the time that the symbol is going to be the first symbol, we don't need to provide any, I don't need to provide with you with any information, you know that it's the first symbol. Okay? Let's now consider an intermediate case. Let's imagine that P1 up to M, M symbols where M is smaller than N appear with equal probability, and the rest of the symbols appear with probability 0. And what do we get from the formula? While you think about it, I will erase the rest of the whiteboard. So I'm waiting for an answer from someone. That's right. It's log 2 of M, and you can see that, you know, you can see it from the formula. For those symbols for which P is 1 over M, we have here log 2 of M multiplied by the sum of the P, which is just 1. So the rest is 0. And this also makes sense. You know, if there are N symbols, but we're actually only using M of them, it's just the same as this case. Okay? But the relevant number of symbols is M. Now let's look at another example in which the probabilities, you know, are not just 0 or 1 over the number of appearing symbols. So let's imagine that we have 5 symbols. N is equal to 5. P1, one symbol appears with probability half. And the symbols 2 to 5 appear with probability 1 over 8. So you can check that the total probability is okay. It's half plus 4 times 4 divided by 8, which is 1. What is the entropy? So let's plug it in the expression. So we have half times log 2 of half. What is log 2 of half? Log 2 of 2, right? Because it's 1 over. Log 2 of 2 is 1. Plus, we have 4 symbols each appearing with probability 1 over 8. And we need to multiply by log 2 of 8, which is 3. Good. So, we have here half plus 3 over 2, which is, something is wrong. Because it's because it's 4 times 1 over 4. Why do I have a 4 here? Oh, I think it's just a mistake in my notes. So this is 2. Okay, let's see if this makes sense. I think it makes sense. Okay, so this is the answer. We need 2 bits. And in principle, it's not obvious, again, it's not obvious how to devise an encoder of this stream of symbols which will allow us to achieve this average number of bits per symbol, but in this particular case, it turns out to be quite easy. Okay? So let me show you how we can encode a stream of these symbols in a stream of bits which will achieve the entropy. So the idea is to use something which is called the prefix code. And the idea is as follows. I give you a stream of bits, and I devise this stream of bits as follows. If the symbol is symbol 1, I just send a 0. Okay? In half the cases, on average, the symbol will be half, and then I send you a 0. If the symbol is one of these symbols, I transmit to you the bit 1. Okay, so you know that it's one of these. And then I use, either a 0 or a 1, two zeros, or, it's two bits. I use two bits to encode the symbol. So 100, say, will be symbol 2. 101 will represent symbol 3. 110 will represent symbol 4. 111 will represent symbol 5. So this is how I encode the stream of bits, but note that if you receive this stream of bits, you can decode it without any ambiguity. Whenever you see a zero, the way you decode is that you get to take the stream of bits, go along this tree according to the stream of bits. Whenever you reach one of the symbols, that's a symbol, and you go back to the top. So if I send you the stream 0111 0101 and so on, you go, this represents symbol 1. Now 111 is symbol 5, 0 is symbol 1, 101 is symbol 3, symbol 0 is symbol 1, and so on. So you can decode, we can encode and we can decode. Let's see how many bits on average we need in this per symbol we need in this encoding scheme. So the average number of bits, what will it be? If the symbol is 0, that happens half the time, we need 1 bit. If the symbol is any one of these 4 symbols, that also appears half the time, we need 3 bits. Right? So we got 2. This is the same as what we had here. And you can see also the connection between, the why this is the same. Now, this particular scheme works perfectly if all the probabilities are powers of half. Then, in any case where all the probabilities appearing here are powers of half, as in this case, you can devise in this simple way a prefix code which will achieve the entropy. If the probabilities don't happen to be powers of half, then you have to work more hard to generate a coding scheme that will achieve the limit of the entropy, but you can still do it. One of the ways to do it is to just concatenate several symbols, okay, and see and consider the combination of the different symbols as one symbol with the larger number of combinations, and then the prefix code can when the number of symbols is larger, it can achieve the entropy. But this is just a comment. In any case, so don't take from this example the notion that you can always use a prefix code to achieve the limit by the entropy. This is just an example. But it's always doable. All right, so these are the examples that I wanted to show you. And if we think about the expression, if we look at the expression which is written here, it's kind of instructive to plot the contribution of each symbol to the entropy, each one of the symbols. So if I plot the combination of this term to the entropy, pi log 1 over pi, how does it look as a function of p? When p goes to 0, as we discussed, it's 0. When p goes to 1, it's also 0. So it looks something like this. But it's 0 for two different reasons in some sense, in these two cases. And one way to see it is to think about this P as coming from just the probability of occurrence of the symbol, right? The contribution to the entropy of each symbol has to do with the likelihood that the symbol will appear, which is this P, but it's multiplied by log 1 over P. Log 1 over P How does that look like? It's 0 when p is 1, and it diverges logarithmically for small p. This is something sometimes called the surprise in the symbol. Why is it called a surprise? If the symbol appears with probability 1, we're never surprised to see it. Okay? And in that case, the contribution of the symbol to the entropy is 0. We don't need any information. I don't need to provide you with you any information to encode the occurrence of a symbol which occurs with probability 1. If the symbol is very rare, the surprise in the symbol is larger. The fact that it appears is a bigger surprise. Okay, it's less fun. And the number of bits that you need to encode the symbol is the multiple of the log of this surprise with the probability that the symbol actually occurs. So again, in this plot, here the contribution of the symbol to the entropy is 0 because the symbol that appears always, you don't need any bits to encode it. Here it's 0 because the symbol just never occurs. Okay, so this is a way to think about it. And the next thing that I want to discuss for a moment is units of the entropy. What are the units of the entropy? Does it have dimensions? Like meters or... No, it doesn't really have dimensions. It's a dimensionless quantity, and nevertheless, we do measure it in some sense in units, which were mentioned here. I think, which are bits. But, okay, so let's talk about for a moment about units. So if we write the entropy as I wrote it, sum over I pi log 2 of pi, then the units are bits. It tells us how many bits we need per symbol to encode the entropy, but often when we will discuss entropy in particular cases, we will prefer to work with another definition, which is using a different base here. So if I would use here a base, instead of base 2, say base 3, it will tell us how many symbols which take 3 values instead of 2 values we need to encode the symbol. But in fact, we will often work with a minus sum over pi, a natural logarithm of pi. And the reason it's convenient to work with a natural logarithm is simply that the derivative of the natural logarithm is more simple. It's 1 over p. And so, for example, if you will want to maximize the entropy of some representation, we will need to take derivative, and it will be convenient to work with natural logarithm. And so sometimes the units, so this is bits, sometimes the units here are called nits instead of bits. And I want to connect this to something that some of you may know. So how many people here have studied physics? 2. Okay, so for the 2 of you, in physics, we define the entropy as minus, almost like this, sum over pi log pi. I'll explain in a moment what are the probabilities here in a physical case, in a physical context, but we multiply it by a factor that has dimensions, which is a Boltzmann factor, a Boltzmann constant. And so in physics, the entropy has dimensions of energy divided by temperature, which are the dimensions of the Boltzmann constant. And what does this actually mean in physics? So in physics, we might consider an ensemble, a physical system, which can occupy a set of states. And the probabilities are the probabilities of the physical system to be in different states. So let me just finish. This is, you know, if you don't care about physics, then this is less important, but you probably, even those who didn't study physics, heard the context, the term entropy in the physical context, so it's nice to understand the connection. So we have a physical system which can be in different states, probability to be in a certain physical state. Units, energy divided by temperature. These are the units. And for those of you who did study statistical physics, you studied about different ensembles, right? So, for example, microcanonical ensemble. What is the probability to be in a particular state? Microcanonical. System in the microcanonical ensemble is determined by an energy, and it has equal probability to be in any state, right? So this just means that when we take this sum, this is like this example, it's just log, but it will be ln of the number of states. So it will be K Boltzmann times ln number of states, states with some energy, ln number of states with energy E. So this is, you know that this is the definition of the entropy in physics, right? But we can also look at the canonical ensemble. And then Pi is some prefactor times exponent of minus Ei divided by K Boltzmann T, right? So you can plug this expression in the expression for the entropy and show that you indeed get the entropy. So maybe we'll give this as an optional exercise to see that if you do this, the expression that you get from the entropy really matches another way to calculate the entropy in physics, in the canonical ensemble. Anyway, so we go back to information theory. But this really means that, it really means that in physics, the notion of entropy, you can think about it as an amount of information that I would require to provide to you in order to specify in which of the possible states the physical system is currently present. Okay, so going back to information theory, I would like to talk about some properties of the entropy. And the first one is, let's ask what is the choice of the PIs which maximizes the entropy. So we have n symbols, and we can choose the PIs to be whatever we want. What will be the choice which will maximize the entropy? Do you think that you know the answer? Does anyone know the answer? Equal probability. That's the situation. If all the symbols appear with equal probability, we will need the maximal amount of bits to transmit them. And one way to see this is just from what we did here. At least in the case where n is where n is a power of 2, then you see that you know if you have say 8 symbols, if the symbol appear in equal probabilities, we need 3 bits to encode them. And of course, we never need more than 3 bits to encode 8 symbols, because we can always connect, you know, one pattern of 3 bits to one of the symbols. So it cannot be that we would need more than 3 bits. So the case where the probabilities are equal saturates gives you the maximum number of bits that you could imagine that would be needed. But let's see this more formally. So what we need to do is to maximize the expression minus sum over I pi log 1 over pi. So if I'm free to choose the pi as I wish, what is the maximum of this expression?
Maybe log pi without the minus, or the other way.
Yes, thank you. Thank you. Okay, so what is the maximum of this expression if I'm free to choose the PIs as I wish? I claim that this expression, the expression that I wrote here, can be infinite.
Yeah.
Right? If I choose all the PIs to be zero, then this expression is infinite. So something here doesn't make sense.
Probability.
Okay, so we need to impose the constraint that the sum of probabilities is equal to one. So we do this by including a Lagrange multiplier. Right? Oops. So because we need to maximize this under the constraint that all the sum of all the PIs is equal to 1. So we have this constraint that sum over PI minus 1 needs to be 0. Okay, so now once we did that, we have a meaningful optimization problem. We can take the derivative with respect to PI, so what do we get? So now I will actually use this is the first case where I will prefer to use the entropy in nits rather than the entropy in bits. Okay? So I'll maximize S instead of H. These two expressions are related to each other by facto. So what do I get? So I take the derivative. What do I get? So here I get ln of 1 over pi. And then I have plus 1 times, this is the derivative with respect to this. And then we have, we can think about this as minus p ln p. So the derivative of ln p is 1 over p, but this is minus ln p, so this is minus 1 over p multiplied by p, so this is minus 1. This is what I get by taking the derivative in this part. And here I have plus lambda, right? This is equal to 0. And so what we got, we actually don't need to do anything further, but if we want, we can. We got here that all the PIs obey the same equation. Right? So all the PIs are some constant. What is this constant?
They have to sum
to 1. So this constant is 1 over n. Okay? So indeed, maximizing the entropy gives us the result all the PIs are the same. You need to check, in principle, you need to check that this is indeed a maximum, not a minimum. I will not do it explicitly. So, the maximum entropy for a collection of n neurons is given by this case, and it's equal to log 2. If we measure it in bits, it's log 2 of n. All right. Now I want to discuss another property of the entropy. And this is additivity for independent variables. So imagine that x and y are independent variables. Each one of these variables is drawn from, can assume a set of discrete states and is drawn independently from some distribution. So x can take one of n states and has probabilities pi where I goes from 1 to n. And y can take one of m states, and let's just put here an x to denote that these are the probabilities of the x's, and the y's can take one of m states, and they're coming from a probability pj m, where j goes from 1 to m. Okay? So I can look at the combination of these two occurrences of x and y as a larger symbol, which takes one of m times n states. X, the combination of an x and a y, is I can think about it as a symbol which takes one of m times n states with probabilities. Since they're drawn independently, their probabilities are simply p I x, p j y, where I tells us which symbol x is taken and j tells us which symbol y is taken, right? So we can calculate the entropy of this combined symbol. So I will write it in terms of the S in nits. So S of this combined symbol, what is it? It's minus sum over all states of this combined symbol, which we need to do this sum, we need to run both over I and over J. So I will go from 1 to N and J will go from 1 to M. And then we need to write the probability and the log of the probability. So the probability is p I x p j y, and then we have ln of p I x p j y. But remember that the ln of a product is the sum of the lons, right? So this is ln p I x plus ln p j y. And now, what happens when we do the sum? Let's look at this term. What will we get from it when we sum over I and j?
The sum over
p1 is 1. The sum over here, the sum over the j's, you know, yeah. So when I take this term, the j's, we simply need to sum over the pj's, and that will sum up to 1. So we will get minus sum over I pix ln PIX multiplied by 1, the sum over the J. And likewise, in the second term, we will get minus sum over J going from 1 to M, I went from I to N, PJ Y ln PJ Y. But this is the entropy associated with variable X, and this is the entropy associated with the variable Y. So overall, we get that when we have a combination of two independent variables, the entropy just sums up. Which makes sense, right? The number of bits, if the variables are independent, I cannot learn anything about one of them by knowing the other one, so the number of bits that I need to encode both of them is just the number of bits that I need to encode one and the number of bits that I need to encode the second. Okay. Now, what happens if the variables are dependent? What can we still say about the entropy of the combinations? That's true, but we'll even say a bit more than that. So, remember that in this case, we can write P of X and Y, the probability of the joint occurrence of P of X and Y, as the probability of X times the conditional probability of Y given X, right? We could also write it as P of Y times the conditional probability of X given Y, whatever we prefer. But this way of writing things allows us to obtain another result, which I will now not derive. I will not derive it in detail. We will do it as an exercise. But I will just quote the result because it's instructive. in the general case, we can start with this expression and show that the entropy of the combined symbol is the entropy of X plus sum over I PI X, the probability for the occurrence of X, times the entropy of Y, conditioned on the fact that that X assumed the option I, symbol I. Another way to write this is that this is S of X times the av plus the average of the entropy of Y given X, average over X, and I will explain what this means. So the relation that I wrote here has a very clear interpretation. The interpretation is that if you want to encode this combination of these two symbols, you can proceed as follows. First, encode X, and the number of bits that you will need is S of X on average. Once you've encoded X, for whatever value X has occurred, you have a conditional probability of Y given X. And this tells you how many bits you would need to add in addition in order to tell me what is Y once I already know what is X. So for example, if Y is completely determined by X, this means that Y assumes only one value given X, then this entropy will be zero. And then, you know, you don't need any additional bits. If you know X, you already know Y. But if Y is completely unrelated to X, independent of X, then this will just be the entropy of Y. But in general, given X, the probability of the distribution of Y might be affected. So this tells you how many bits, again, how many bits you need to encode Y once you know X. And we need to average this over the probability distribution of X. So this is the interpretation. Again, it's the amount of information needed to encode X plus the amount of information needed to encode Y given X averaged over the probability of X. And we'll talk more about dependent variables later. Probably on Tuesday. And the last thing that I want to mention about properties of the entropy is uniqueness. So overall, the entropy is just some function of the PIs, right? Some function, this particular function of the PIs. But it turns out that you can start by making some assumptions about how this function, some assumptions that this function has to obey, and based on these assumptions, you can show that this is the only way to define the entropy. And these two assumptions are the following. One is that if you just take the particular case where all the PIs are 1 over n, okay, then this function is an increasing function of n, monotonically increasing function of n. So, you know, you need more info. We try to generate some notion of information. It has to be some function of the PIs, and one thing that we know about it is that you will need more information to encode 4 symbols that appear with equal probability than to encode 3 symbols that appear with equal probability. Okay, so this is a very benign assumption, which is of course very, very clear that it has to, a notion of information should obey. The other more important notion is the additivity. Both independent and conditional. So it's really these two results. This result and this result. So it can be shown that if you assume that if you try to devise a measure of information which is a function of the PI which obeys these two quantities, these two properties, then actually this is the only way to define it, up to a prefactor. The prefactor has, you can interpret as, you know, the units in which you're measuring the entropy. So there's unique, it's a unique function. Up to units, and this is also something that Shannon showed. What was the question?
You don't really need the additivity of the independent constant.
You don't?
Like, it counts if you just define the standard.
I think, okay, from what I remember, I will check it. From what I remember, this was needed in the proof, but maybe I'm wrong. I will check. Okay? You claim that you don't.
You just need to say that for any two variables, then that f of x and y is f of x and
You don't need the independent.
Yeah.
You say that, that's right. The independent is a particular case of the dependent. That's absolutely true. Yes. Okay. You're a mathematician, so you're more. You want me to be very precise. Okay. I mean, it's what I wrote is correct, but indeed, this is not this is redundant. The fact, why the fact that I said this, I also said the first. Okay, so let's. I think this is a good time for a break, and then we'll define another type of entropy. Okay. Netta asked me to clarify that she's not giving the TA now, but she will do the extra hour for those of you who wish to attend. And now what I would like to do is the following. So we defined the entropy, and the entropy was defined for a variable, a symbol that takes discrete values, right? Discrete values. Now the question is whether we can generalize this concept to variables which are continuous. So this leads us to define something which is called the differential entropy. So let's imagine that we have a variable that takes a continuous one-dimensional values. So it takes a real value x. And so this variable is characterized by a probability density function. P of x. And this P of x has the property that the integral of P of x dx from minus infinity to infinity is equal to 1. And now let me pose to you the question, how many bits would I need to precisely tell you what is x? Infinite. Yeah, that's a correct answer. If you want to precisely know where is x, and the number of bits you will need is infinite, so it seems like maybe we run into a difficulty there. If you want to define an entropy as the number of bits needed to encode a symbol, that's infinite. However, what we can imagine is a situation in which you don't really care about x very, very precisely. So let's imagine that we bin the x variable into equally spaced bins. Okay, so we do a discretization. X is really continuous, but let's imagine a situation where we're discretizing x with bins of size delta x, and we draw x from this continuous probability distribution, and but all I want to specify to you, or you need to specify to me, is not the precise value of x, but in which bin it fell. Okay? So then we're in the situation where we have a discrete variable, the identity of the bin. And we can ask, what is the entropy associated with that information? Let's call that h of x delta x entropy associated with the bin version of x. So for one thing, just as we discussed a minute ago, when delta x approaches zero, we expect this to approach infinity, right? If I tell you, when delta x approaches zero, we're specifying x precisely, and we realize that we expect this to be infinite, the amount of information to be infinite. But for finite x, this is well defined and finite. And moreover, as you will see, if delta x is small, we get a nice expression, simple expression. So let's do it. So, what is h of x delta x? Well, when delta x becomes small, we can approximate this quantity by the probability of being, you know, the probability of being in the bin I will be, in each one of the bins, the probability is more or less constant. So we can approximate the probability of being, okay, let's first write it let's write it as minus sum pi ln pi, where pi is the probability to be in bin I. But when delta x is small, we can approximate this as p of xi times delta x. Right? In this case, pi is approximately equal to p of xi delta x. So we have here sum over I, p of xi delta x, ln of p of xi delta x. Now, I can open up this ln into two terms. So this is minus sum over I, let me put the delta x in front. So we have minus sum over I p of xi ln p of xi. And the other term will be ln delta x multiplied by the sum over I p of xi times delta x. What is that? Okay, I'll write it explicitly. So we have sum over I p of xi delta x times ln delta x. So what can we say about this? What is this? What when delta x becomes small? It's the integral. I'll write approximately because both here and here approximate when delta x is small, but this is, or I can do, you know, an arrow, it approaches when delta x goes to zero, is the integral of p of x ln p of x dx from minus infinity to infinity. And here, this is just the integral, becomes the integral of p of x, which is 1. Right? So we're left with minus log of delta x, which I can also write as plus ln of 1 over delta x. No, we did not assume this can be from minus infinity to infinity. There are some hidden assumptions which I will not detail, you know, continuity, that it's not that, you know, it has to be, well, you know, p of x has to be a function that integrates to 1.
Yeah,
it's a probability. But you can also see, it's clear when, for, you know, for how small delta x should be for this relationship to hold. Delta x should be sufficiently small that p of x is more or less constant in each one of the bins. So it has to be some scale over which the probability is smooth. Probability density function is smooth. Okay, in any case, so this is what we got, and now you see that as long as the probability distribution function is continuous and we can do what the exercise that we did here, the dependence of delta x becomes very simple when delta x is small. It's encapsulated only in this part. So as we discussed, when delta x goes to 0, this goes to infinity. So if you want to precisely know where the symbol is, you will need an infinite number of bits. But as long as delta x is small but finite, the number of bits that you will need is ln, or nits, this is in nits because this is ln. The number of nits that you will need is ln of 1 over delta x plus this quantity, and this quantity is called the differential entropy. With the minus. This is like the minus that appears in the regular entropy, minus p log p. So this is the differential entropy. And it is defined as the limit where delta x goes to 0 of h of x delta x minus ln 1 over delta x. And it's equal to the minus the integral of p of x ln p of x dx from minus infinity to infinity. This is the differential entropy.
Differential entropy is only the first term?
It's this term. This is just a property of the probability density function. As you can see, it does not depend on delta x. If you bin and you ask how many bits, so the real way to think about the differential entropy is by this construction. You have a probability density function. The property of the differential entropy is that if you bin with bins of equal size, size delta x, and these bins are small, the number of bits that you will need to encode the identity of the symbol is the differential entropy plus ln 1 over delta x. When delta x goes to 0, it diverges. But for any small delta x, when delta x is sufficiently small, this is finite. This is the entropy will be given by this relationship. No, because I subtracted it. So this is the limit as delta x goes to 0 of this minus this part. And this is finite when delta x goes to 0. You can see it here. It's this integral. Right? So, okay, this is a good point. Exactly. So, the differential entropy can be negative. Doesn't have to be positive. In contrast, actually, I'm not sure that I wrote in the properties of the entropy. A very important property of the regular entropy is that it's always positive because it's a sum of positive terms. Let's add that. Just going back to the regular entropy. But the differential entropy can be positive and can be negative. the sign doesn't mean much of the differential entropy. Okay. Right, so this is exactly how we reach this concept of the differential entropy. But essentially, again, if you want, delta x is, in some sense, that if you bin, delta x is a precision in which is a precision in which you're encoding the variable. We'll come back to this point, probably not today, but on Tuesday, so maybe it will make more sense then. Yes? Yeah, so this is very much similar to what Gal asked. Suppose that the game would be that you have some noise, you have some... suppose, for example, that X is corrupted by noise, okay, with some variance. And then what you care about is the X itself, you don't care about the noise. So it turns out that then the differential entropy is really represents the amount of information that you need to encode X.
So it doesn't matter in which sense, like what your error function.
Oh, it matters a lot. So this is an important point that we'll also come back to. That I assumed that the binning is equal, right? I assumed that the interval, the size of the interval, does not depend on X. Right?
So in some cases we can improve.
Now suppose that this is related to the amount of information that you need to transmit if the degree to which you care about X is the same regardless of what is X. Suppose that the situation would be that you care more about precision here than you care about precision here and you would bin in a non-equal manner, then you will reach some other expression. Okay? Then so the differential entropy is really a useful quantity in the situation in which the precision in which you care about X is the same for the regardless of X.
Is there any general form of differential entropy where you can specify some wave function?
You could generalize it. You can think about it. So one way to think about it, suppose that again the delta X would be a function of X times something that goes to zero. Okay? And you can ask yourself then, if you would play the same game here, how would the amount of information depend on delta x? And you will see that you will have something that looks like this, but here you will have something different than before that will involve both p of x and the precision and the coarseness of the... Maybe. Maybe we should discuss this later because I'm not sure that you... For now, I think you're also... Your definition is still fuzzy, so you need to think a bit more how to define it. But probably, yes. Probably you could do something in the lines that you're thinking of, along the lines that you're thinking of. Okay, so... So this is the differential entropy, and now let's look at two examples. So the first example will be a uniform distribution on some range. So in some interval 0, L. So this means that P of X is equal to 1 if X is between 0 and L, and 0 otherwise. Right? What is the... Yeah, 1 over n, thank you. And I noticed now another thing, which is, I will not correct what I'm writing here, because, but I wrote, I used aged here, but, and I used lan. And remember that I used lan with a log 2 with age, and I tried to use s with lan. But so in principle, it would be nicer to use s here everywhere, or to use log 2, just to remind us. But it's almost the same. It's just the units, nits or bits. All right, so I will continue to work with nits, just because it's most of the time that's what we do. So. And so I will use S for here, and I will go back to S, and I will try to do it, but if I don't, you understand what I'm doing. So in this case, what is S? The differential entropy? Well, it's minus integral from 0 to L, because we have a P of X, and P of X is 0 outside that region, so we have P of X itself, times ln of 1 over L dx. So integral, this is a constant, integral of 1 over L from 0 to L is 1, so we get ln L, right? In some sense, you know what, okay, this comment I will keep for later. So okay, so this is one example. And now let's see, look at a somewhat more interesting example. So this was example one. Example two will be a Gaussian variable. T of x is equal to 1 over square root of 2 pi sigma squared exponent of minus x minus mu squared divided by 2 sigma squared. Right, so this is a variable for which the probability distribution looks like this. This is mu, and this is sigma. Okay, let's do the math. Again, the expression, because we don't have it on the whiteboard, so it's minus integral of P of X ln P of X dx minus infinity to infinity. And so I can write this as follows. I will keep P of X for now, but I will write ln P of X explicitly. So when we take the ln of a product, it's the sum of the ln. So one of the things that we have is the ln of 1 over square root of 2 pi sigma squared, which is minus the ln of square root of 2 pi sigma squared. So I will write here minus ln of square root of 2 pi sigma squared. And then we have the ln of this, which is very simple because it's the ln of an exponent. So we just remove the exponent. So we have x minus mu squared divided by 2 sigma squared. And I claim that we know immediately what this is equal to. What will come out of the first term? We have constant, just this constant, because we have an integral of P of X from minus infinity to infinity, which is 1. So from the first term we get ln of square root 2 pi sigma squared. But I claim that this is also very simple. What is integral of P of X, X minus mu squared? It's a variance, but what is the variance? It's sigma squared. So when we take the integral of P of X times this, just without a denominator, we got sigma squared. And then it's divided by 2 sigma squared, so we just end up with half. So we have here a half. And therefore, I can also write this as the ln of, first of all, this is half ln 2 pi sigma squared plus half. Right? And then I can also write this as half as ln as half ln of 2 pi e sigma squared, because ln of e is 1, so this will give us the half here, and we'll and then also half ln 2 pi sigma squared. Okay, so this is the answer. And you, for one thing, you can see that the wider the Gaussian, the larger the entropy. But now let us remind ourselves what this means. This what this really means, that if we bin with bins with width with small width delta x, the amount of information, the number of bits required to encode will be half ln 2 pi e sigma squared minus half, sorry, minus ln of 1 over delta x. But I can also write this as half ln of 2 pi e sigma squared divided by delta x squared. Right? And what you see, therefore, is something that makes a lot of sense, is that whatever the only thing that matters is the ratio between sigma and delta x. So if you take a Gaussian which is twice as wide, but you bin it in bins which are twice as large, the amount of information that you will need to encode the variable will be exactly the same. Right? Does that make sense? Some of you are, seems like they agree, and some seem confused. Okay, so the answer that we got is that this depends on the ratio of sigma and delta x, and I claim that this is something that we could have understood without doing any of the math, that it has to be that way, because there are some units here, x has units, and the units are that shouldn't matter. I mean, suppose that sigma is twice as wide, the Gaussian is twice as wide, but we bin the variable x with bins which are twice as large, well, it's exactly the same situation. So the number of bits that we will need to encode the variable should not depend, you know, should only depend on the ratio of sigma and delta x. We can do the same trick, by the way. Let's go back to example one and do this also in example one. So in example one, the number of bits required after binning will be ln L minus 1 over minus a ln over 1 over delta x, which is nothing but ln of L divided by delta x. So again, if we have a variable which is in the interval 0 to L, and we bin it with bins which are of size delta x, the only thing that matters is how many bins there are within the interval, which is L divided by delta x. Right? You with me? If not, say it. It's fine. Just I will explain. Okay? So, if you're not completely convinced by what I said, and you, for some reason, you're not asking, then think about it later on and convince you, see that you understand it. All right. Now, let's see how we're doing on time. Okay, so one other thing that I want to do is consider some optimization problems. So let's consider the following problem. Right, so, no, so, Okay, I will discuss this question for a bit. The question was whether the sign of the differential entropy is meaningful. And the answer is that it's not, and the reason is that essentially the P of X has units in it, because X has units. You can think about X is a variable with units. You saw that also in the answer that we got here, that what matters really is the sigma squared divided by delta X squared. And so if you do a change of units, you replace X by alpha X, then you can make the entropy positive or negative depending on alpha, differential entropy. And therefore the differential, it's also because the differential entropy is like an average of a lambda, so a positive or negative is like multiplying by something. The sign doesn't mean anything. All right. Yes, it's plus because, yeah, that's right.
And over there on the right as well.
Okay, thank you. Yes, thank you. It's minus lambda delta x. Yes. Okay, so now I want to discuss the following problem. We have a variable x, which is defined in the range, x can only take values in the range 0, 1. And the question that I would like to ask is, what is the distribution, probability distribution of X, which maximizes the differential entropy? Under this constraint. So what do you think will be the answer? Uniform, right? Because this is a, if we think about differential entropy as a generalization of the regular entropy, we saw that for the regular entropy, the distribution with maximal entropy was uniform, the same probability for each value. And so it makes sense that this will be the answer. But let's see how we can do it formally. So this is very similar to what we did when we considered the discrete case with some differences. So I would maximize now a quantity which I will call, which sometimes we call it the Lagrangian. We will do very many similar things later on in the remaining weeks of the course. And this is the differential entropy itself. This is what we want to maximize. But as in the discrete case, we also need to include the constraint that the probability P sums up to 1. Right? So this integral goes now from 0 to 1 because we know P of X is defined to be 0 everywhere else. So this goes from 0 to 1, but we need to add also the constraint. We will add the constraint using a Lagrange multiplier. But the difference with respect to what we did in the discrete case is now what is the nature of the variables that we are varying. There are functions, right? In the discrete case, we varied the PIs, which were each PI was a number. Here we're varying the whole function P of X. So first of all, something like this, which is a function of a function, with the L is a function of the function P of X, is called a functional. L is a functional, this is just a technical term, the functional of P of X. P of X itself is a function. You give me the function, I tell you what is L. And we're now maximizing with respect to the value of P of X at any X. So this is called functional optimization or functional maximization. And I will not go into a formal discussion about how to do it. I will just do it very simple-mindedly as if we are differentiating with respect to regular numbers, and you will see what we will get out of it. And for those of you who never saw functional differentiation, you will do more of this with Netta. But what I want to, what the way I think about it is that P of X, again, variables are the P's for every X, but instead of P being labeled by a discrete index, like PI that we had before, it's labeled by a variable, continuous variable X. But I will think about the value of P of X for each possible X as if it's a separate parameter that I'm differentiating with respect to that parameter. So what I will now write is the requirement that the derivative of delta of L with respect to the value of P at position X is zero. But I use this delta instead of D because this is not a regular derivative. P of X itself is part of a function. So this is just the notation. And I'm not explaining formally what it really means, but it, we can kind of, without, if we don't think too much, it's clear what we should do. This integral, how it depends on P of X, it depends on only on if, you know, if you want to take some, think about this now as an integration variable. So we can put like an X prime over here on each position. So X prime is just an integration variable, and we want now the differential with respect to P of a particular X. So then it does not care about all the other X primes. The contribution comes only in the case where X prime is given to X. And that contribution will be, well, we just need to take the derivative of this function with respect to P of X. So it's minus ln P of X minus, you know, that when we take the derivative, this is when I took the derivative with respect to this, and then when I take the derivative with respect to this, I get P of X divided by P of X, so that's minus 1. And then in this integral, in the same way, we get a contribution only from the X prime, which is equal to X, and that contribution is simply lambda. So this is, has to be zero, and therefore we got the result. Same with well, yeah, so you need to think about it more carefully. One way to think about it, which is very useful, is to imagine that the function is really a limit of the case where you have discrete variables. So you discretize X, okay? And suppose that actually, which is like saying you have a function which is, has constant values in intervals, okay, in small intervals, and then everything is you can do as a regular derivative, and that's how you can connect, you know, the way you think about the regular derivative and this kind of derivative. But I know I just don't want to start doing it formally because we can spend, you know, 2 hours now discussing this, and that's not the point. You will do more of this with Netta. She will also not precisely formalize it, but by doing some examples, you will get a feeling for how to do it correctly. All right, so in any case, what we got now is that P of X is a constant, right? And that constant has to be 1 because the integral of P of X from 0 to 1 has to be 1. Okay, let me just mention another optimization problem that you will discuss more in with Netta as an exercise. So, suppose that X is defined on the full range minus infinity to infinity, and we are looking for a probability distribution which obeys the following constraints. We want the average of X to be mu, and we want the variance of X to be sigma square. Okay? And then we want to look for the probability distribution that maximizes the entropy under these constraints. maximizes S of X under these constraints. Of course, there's a third constraint, which is just the fact that it's a probability distribution. The integral from 0, from minus infinity to infinity, has to be 1. But in addition, the integral of X times P of X has to be mu, and the integral of X squared times P of X has to be sigma squared plus mu squared. These are the constraints. So you can imagine, I will not do it now, but you can imagine how we would approach the problem. We would write a Lagrangian, which would include the entropy itself, plus three constraints. Each constraint has its own Lagrange multiplier. One constraint is that the integral of P is 1. One constraint is that the integral of X times P of X is mu. Third constraint is the constraint of the variance. And then we can take functional derivatives and see what we get. And the answer ends up being very simple. It's a Gaussian. So a Gaussian is uniquely determined by its mean and its variance, and that ends up being the answer. So a Gaussian is a distribution function that maximizes the differential entropy under a constraint on the mean and a constraint on the variance, and this will be important for us in the coming weeks. You can also do this for a multidimensional Gaussian. So, you know, you have a set of variables, you want to constrain their means and their covariances, and you end up with a multidimensional Gaussian. That's the distribution that maximizes the entropy under these constraints. All right, so I will end here because we now need to start a new topic. The next lesson, we go back to neurons. We discuss neurons.